Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is January the 29th, 2017. This is the fourth Sunday after Epiphany. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Opening hymn for our 10:30 service, St. John's Lutheran Church. Rise up, O saints of God. We are a remnant. We are here. We're worshiping God. We are rising up. We are leaving vain ambition. We are merciful as God is merciful. St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio.
Thank you. Let us pray. Holy God, you confound the world's wisdom in giving your kingdom to the lowly and the pure in heart. Give us such a hunger and thirst for justice and perseverance in striving for peace, that in our words and deeds, the world may see the life of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated as we listen to the reading of God.
The readings today are done by Kim Jackson.
The first lesson this morning is from Micah, chapter 6. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the controversy of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a controversy with his people, and he will contend with Israel. Oh, my people, what have I done to you, and what have I wearied you? Answer me, for I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. Oh, my people, remember now what King Balak of Moab devised, what Balaam, son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the saving acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you to do but justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God? This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose Let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Acclamation.
The
pastor is Pastor John Pollock, reading the Gospel.
Glory to you, Lord. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you, and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way, they persecuted the prophets who were before you. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you. First of all, on a happy note, you may notice that my nephew, Sergeant Geraci's name does not appear in the prayer list this morning. That is because to report that he came home this past Wednesday. So his tour in Iraq is over, and he is back safe at Fort Campbell with his wife and with his mother not too far away. So thank you for all your prayers while Dustin was serving with the 101st over in Iraq. Also, as I think everyone is aware, we unexpectedly lost our brother Terry Anderson this week. The funeral service was yesterday. Still, as if you remember, Linda and Tara and Ryan and Donna, in your prayers and your acts of sympathy as they mourn Terry's unexpected call to the church, triumphant from the church militant. And then one final note, some of you probably have heard this already, but council voted for the month of February to have only one service at 9:30. Sunday school will be at 8:30, with church then at 9:30. The reasoning was due to the fact that a lot of times in February, the 8 o'clock service, the temperature is in single digits and the roads are bad. And on such Sundays, we'll have 4, 5, 10 people. We don't want anybody to get hurt by trying to be here by 8 o'clock. We decided on 9:30, kind of a compromise, because if we made it at 10, then that would be too late for some of the 8 o'clock people. So please bear with us through the month of February. March, we go back to 2 services, so it's just for February. So next week, church will be at 9:30 and Sunday school at 8:30. Now I ask that you give your attention to the choir or the praise band as they give us a bless us with a special number of this one.
Thank you.
looking at your sermon notes for today as we explore Micah chapter 6, verse 8, and consider how to revive a country. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Ever since the mid-80s, when the evangelicals organized the Christian March on Washington, we have heard a lot said about the need to revive our country, the need to reemphasize or reinstitute the morals and values on which our nation was founded. Every time a president is elected, the new president promises that he has a plan to revive our nation and to take care of its ills. And so a new president will propose new ideas, and sometimes they are accepted, sometimes they are met with some reservation, and sometimes they are met with flat-out opposition, even from members of the president's own party. But a change in political leadership, whether it's every 2 years, every 4 years, or every 8 years, will not revive a country by itself. Many of the problems that face our nation are problems that cannot be legislated, cannot be changed by a changed policy, cannot be blown away by an executive order, but are problems of the heart. Problems of the mind, problems of attitudes that one has developed over the years. And so, in order to revive a nation, to revive a country, to revive a state, a county, or a city, we need to look in another direction. And of course, that direction is the Word of God. In our first reading for this morning, the book of the prophet Micah, Micah is proclaiming the word of God to both the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah. Both countries are in need of being revived. Over the years, they have allowed pagan influences into their society and into their ways of life so that they are doing things that violate the covenant that they had sworn to uphold and to live by, that covenant that was made by God with Moses on Mount Sinai as the Hebrew children were freed from bondage in Egypt and heading to the promised land, which was now, of course, Israel and Judah. And so Micah delivers to them the word of the Lord, and his words are as relevant today as they were when he spoke them centuries ago. So let us return to that sixth chapter and to the second part of that eighth verse, where once again we hear the prophet Micah proclaim, "And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God?" What does the Lord require of you? That word, Hebrew word translated into English as require, is a Hebrew word which means to pursue something. It means to seek it out. It means to seek with care. It means to be a frequent part of your daily life. So the prophet Micah is saying that God is saying to Israel and Judah and to us today, that in our daily life we are to pursue, we are to seek out, we are to seek with care, we are frequently to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with our God. So the first step in reviving a nation is to do justice. Now justice is a word that we hear often nowadays. We hear it in the news almost every night. But there is a difference between what some humans demand as justice and what God means by the term justice. Too often today, when a group says that they are demanding justice. In reality, what they are demanding is special treatment or an opportunity to take something or to gain something from somebody else. They do not consider the fact that what they are claiming as justice will do harm to others. That is not what God means by justice. The Hebrew word translated as justice in our text for today means rightness rooted in God's character. Rightness rooted in God's character. To harm no one, to promote the welfare of others. As I said, today too often groups screaming for justice, to have the justice that they want would be to harm others. It would harm those who disagree with them, those who are different than them. That's not God's justice. God's justice is to treat with absolute fairness everyone, regardless of your feelings toward that person or regardless of your relationship with that person. So just as God does not take into consideration what family we're descended from, just like God does not consider what our educational level is or our socioeconomic status, just like God does not concern himself about what country we're from or what language we speak, but treats everyone fairly, that is what we as the children of the Lord Jesus Christ, children of the Heavenly Father, we are called to do in our daily life as well. That we are to treat with absolute fairness everyone, no matter our feelings toward them or no matter our relationship with them. The word also means to be fair and honest. That is God's justice. We see that God's justice is not self-centered. God does not base his justice on himself, but on what is fair. But how many in society today claiming or screaming for justice, how many of them base that claim on self-centeredness, on something they want, not what is best for society or best for our nation? God's justice is not based on what can I gain or what can I take from somebody else. God's justice is based on relating to one another as God expects us to relate to one another. And how did Jesus tell us we are to relate to one another? First, he told us that the first commandment was to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, and with all of our mind. Then he said the second commandment is like it, that we love one another as we love ourselves. Then he goes on to further clarify that in another incident where he says that we should treat others as we want to be treated. The golden rule. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. That is the basis of God's justice. That is what God wants to see us society. And so to revive a nation, to revive a country, we begin by doing justice. Not making decisions based on self-centeredness, not making judgments based on what we might gain, not making judgments based on what we might take from somebody else, but to love our neighbor as ourselves and to do to them what we would want them to do for us. So that is the first step, to do justice, true justice, not justice that is attainable by one idea or another, not justice that's tainted by one group that's in power and oppresses a group that does not have the power. To do justice is to be like God, to treat everyone fair, to be honest and fair. So that is the first step. The second step in reviving a country or reviving a nation is that we must love kindness. For years, we have been hearing comments saying that America is not as compassionate as she used to be. That America remember a day and time when you could go next door to your neighbor and ask them for a cup of sugar. We remember that day and time where if we lived in the city, we went out in the morning and did not come back until the street lights came on. Or if you lived in the country, you went outside and you didn't come back in until Sunday. No one had to call you. You just knew that was when you were supposed to be there. We remember a day and time when we would walk down the street and greet one another, and nobody thought you were odd. Or we would go into a store or into a restaurant and treat those who are waiting on us or serving us with kindness and smile and ask them how their day was going. But today, depending on where you are, you can walk down the street and smile at somebody and say hi, and they look at you like they think you're going to mug. Or you can have an experience like I had when we were up in Oyster Bay, Long Island, New York, for our middle son's wedding. And it was the day of the rehearsal, so I didn't have anything to do until that evening. So Gina was busy helping the mother of the bride fix up things in the house for the rehearsal dinner that night. I went to the local Dunkin' Donuts. And as I got out of my car, I walked up to the door, and a couple of ladies were behind me, so I opened the door for them. And as they walked in, I smiled and said, hi, if looks could kill, I wouldn't be standing here right now. I went up to the counter to order my coffee and a donut and asked the person how they were doing, how their day was going, and they just gave me this cold, hard stare. We saw in the past political election how harsh we can be towards one another when we disagree on who should be president of the United States. We see people who aren't even speaking to each other anymore because they disagree on the candidate or the policies. That's not the way America has been. America has always been that melting pot, been that place where people came from all over the world to become Americans and adopt an American way of life based on the Judeo-Christian heritage. Based on the founding of it, based on the Ten Commandments and the Golden Rule and the Sermon on the Mount, which we read today. Based on that you came forever from wherever you came from and left those ways behind to adopt a new way of being, just simply an American. But today, we see an America that there are no more just Americans. Oh, actually, there are just Americans. But everybody identifies themselves as a hyphenated American. You're German American, or Scott American, Irish American. You're Hispanic American, Asian American. You're Pacific American, African American. No one's just an American. But for a country to revive, we must love kindness, which means to be a blessing to others. It means to use yourself for the welfare of your neighbor. It means to seize every opportunity to help your neighbor. Remember the days when you would see somebody, especially a woman, or you would see a teenager, or you would see a man who had looked like he had some kind of physical limitation on the side of the road with a flat tire, and you thought nothing of pulling over and helping them change their flat tire. Well, now today, unfortunately, people have pulled over to help someone change their flat tire, and it's been a scam in order to steal that person's car or to rob them. And so it makes us leery of helping our neighbor. But that's what to love kindness means, to be a blessing to others, to use yourself for the welfare of your neighbor, to seize every opportunity to help your neighbor. Going back to what I was talking about, how when you lived in a neighborhood, you knew everybody from one end to the other, you helped each other with projects around each other's homes, you helped each other with the street you lived on to keep things clean and neat, you watched each other's houses, even watched each other's kids, and you thought nothing of it. And if little Jimmy fell off your porch and busted his lip, you never would dream of suing the family, the homeowners, for little Jimmy falling off the porch. Probably what would happen is little Jimmy would end up standing in the corner or having his backside warmed up for being foolish enough to have fallen off the porch. So the revival must love kindness. The word also means a love that is loyal and steadfast. That it doesn't change because of the weather. It doesn't change because of political winds. It doesn't change because of social upheavals. It means a loyalty to one's community. Be loyal to where you live. The Hebrew word in the book, it's used in the book of Psalms, but in the book of Psalms, it refers to God's grace for humanity. Martin Luther describes this Hebrew word as being, quote, goodness in action, in the world. It is a love that is unable to wear out. Remember I said at the beginning that some think America is on compassion overload, compassion drain, compassion burnout, because we've constantly been asked to help because of disasters in our country like Hurricane Katrina, hurricanes before that, and floods and tornadoes. We've been asked to help nations suffering from tsunamis and earthquakes. We've had those places in Africa that just seem to have famine year after year after year. So some say that we have become burned out. But this word means we never wear out. That compassion never goes out because of that great compassion God has for us. Because another meaning of this Hebrew word translated as love kindness is the meaning of God's unwavering devotion to the salvation of his people fulfilled in the cross of Jesus Christ. In other words, that to revive our nation, we should have that love towards others that God had for us that never wore out, constantly seeking us to come to salvation, loving us so much that finally he sent his only son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Loving us so much that he allowed the death of his son upon that cross to pay the debt of sin that we owe, so that salvation would be ours simply by accepting that atoning death, so that no longer would we need to worry about have we done enough to earn salvation. He loved us so much that he took away the idea of earning salvation, but made it instead a free gift. A free gift for those who believe in the Son, Jesus Christ. So for a nation to revive, we must love kindness. We must make ourselves available to our neighbor. We must be a blessing to others. We must look for that opportunity to help our neighbor. Which then brings us to the third requirement, or the third step in reviving a nation. And that is to revive a nation must walk humbly with God. The word humbly means not to be smug. That means not looking for praise and glory that is owed to God alone. It means not to become proud. It means not to please oneself, but to please God. It means to be modest and reverential. It means always conscious of our dependence on God. That is to be humble before God. But how many people today do we see who emphasize themselves, who are smug, who are proud, whose attitude is, it's my way or the highway, and will not listen to compromise, or not listen to different ideas? How many people today do we see want their 15 minutes of fame? And so they flood social media with their pictures and with their quotes and telling us everything they have done for the day just so people will give them some attention. Be give all credit to God. No, we're not concerned about being popular in the world. Our only concern is being popular with God. The word walk is a Hebrew word used oftentimes to define one's way of life or the way one lives their life. It also has the meaning of to keep up, to stay in step, to match someone step for step, or to do as God does. So when the prophet tells us we are to walk humbly with God, he says we are to be humble as we do as God does. We are to be humble as we serve God through our actions to our neighbor. So to walk humbly with God is close to loving kindness. They almost go hand in hand. But it is that willingness to be that little Christ in the morning, to not be smug, to not be proud, to not always be looking for attention from others. Some of you will remember the artist Paul Simon, originally the famous part of the duo Simon and Garfunkel, whose two most popular famous records probably were Ms. Robinson from the movie The Graduate, and then Bridge Over Troubled Water. Well, after the 70s, 60s, and 70s, and all the popularity, Art Garfunkel decided to retire from the music business and go back to teaching school, while Paul Simon continued in the music profession and had a number of hits as a solo artist. Well, in 2001, in the month of February, Rolling Stone magazine interviewed him. And this is what Paul Simon had to say, which is an attitude that sums up many today who refuse to walk humbly with God. He said, quote, "The only thing that God requires from us is to enjoy life and love. It doesn't matter if you accomplish anything. You don't have to do anything. All you got to do is appreciate that you're alive and love. That's the whole point." What a selfish and self-centered attitude toward life. You don't have to do anything. Go on and walk by that hungry person. Go ahead and ignore the person lying in the road who's been beaten. Go ahead and ignore the starving children in Africa or wherever they may be. Go ahead and ignore the problems in society. Just as long as you appreciate the fact that you're alive and you have someone to love, which coming out of the era that Paul Simon did probably means have someone for sex, then that's all God requires. I love how untrained sinners suddenly try to be theologians without any training. God requires much more than that. And we heard Michael the prophet tell us what he requires. Much more than just saying, gee, I'm glad I'm alive and I'm going to love someone. It means accomplishing things. It means doing things for justice for all people, for loving kindness, practicing kindness for all people, for walking humbly with God. That is what he requires. So if we're going to revive a nation, we can continue down the path of an attitude like Paul Simon. Or we can listen to the prophet Michael, foreshadowing the teaching of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because when Jesus tells us to love our neighbor as ourself, when Jesus tells us to do unto others as we would have them do unto us, when Jesus tells us in that upper room the night of his betrayal, before he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane, before his passion, suffering, and death, and gives to us, his followers, that new commandment that we love one another as he has loved us. When we hear those words that echo the prophet Michael, we know that there is more to life than simply appreciating the fact that we're alive and loving someone. So, to revive a nation, it takes more than new policies. It takes more than legislation, because you can't legislate one's soul or mind. It takes more than executive orders. It takes more than policy changes. It takes people change. And people only change when they're convicted of sin by the Word of God. People only change when they realize their need for the Savior, Jesus Christ. People only change when they take their faith seriously and truly do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with our God. That revives the nation. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Now sing Revive Us Again, which is on the back cover of your bulletin. And no, this hymn was not picked because of my sermon this morning. This hymn was actually picked at the beginning of January when I had no idea what I'd be preaching about today. It's just one of those ways the Holy Spirit works. The hymn after the sermon and the sermon bulletin we're talking about being revived. So, Revive Us Again on the back of your bulletin.
This hymn was written by Scottish doctor William McKay. He had turned away from God. His mother had given him a Bible when he was a young man. And when he was with a man who was dying, this man had the Bible, and it was his Bible. And this brought him back to God and revived him again, that God would bring his own Bible that his mother had prayed over and written in and give it to him when he was at a man's side, when the man died. He's a doctor, Scottish doctor. Revive Us Again.
He is seated at the right hand of the Father.
and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray that the dawn from on high will shine for the church, the world, and all those in need. Our response today is, hear us, we pray. For the church, that living in the blessedness of the commonwealth of heaven, we may show care for those who are lowly and downtrodden. God of light and life, hear us, we pray. For those persecuted for their faith, that they will find strength in the message of Christ crucified and have their hope sustained. God of light and life, hear us, we pray. For the leaders of nations, that they serve their people as peacemakers and messengers of reconciliation. God of light and life, hear us, we pray. For the poor in spirit, for all who suffer depression, poverty, or illness, that you lift them to new life and health. God of light and life, hear us, we pray. For those who mourn and grieve the loss of loved ones, that you would comfort and console them. God of light and life, hear us, we pray. Remember all the saints who have cared for the poor and lived humbly with justice and kindness, that their example sustain our ministry. God of light and life, hear us, we pray. God of splendor and light, hear our prayers and illumine us with the radiance of your glory, shown in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
It's time for our offering. Our ushers are Sharon Leach and Helen Wallace. This is our 10:30 service. But next week, we're going to start with a 9:30 service. Sunday school is going to be at 8:30. We want to honor those who gave flowers today. Flowers were given by Sue Thompson in loving memory of Brother Fred Early, who left the church militant to the church triumphant on January 20, 2017. The flowers also Ron and Maylee Pruitt to the glory of God. Listen to the singers singing during the offering.
art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless, comfort, strengthen, and keep us, now and forever. Amen. We conclude our worship with the Spirit send us forth to serve, hymn number 551 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 551.
This is a modern hymn written by an American, Dolores Duffer, born in 1939. This hymn tells us that we should serve others. We go in Jesus' name to bring glad tidings to the poor. And this is, goes with our sermon today. What we're supposed to do is serve others, love God, and love your neighbor. It was written by Dolores Duffer, born in 1939. The Spirit sends us forth to serve. On YouTube. Tune in anytime. We have our Sunday service. Next Sunday will be a 9:30 service. Today is a 10:30 service. Next Sunday we'll have Sunday school at 8:30 and church service at 9:30. It's just going to be during the month of February. It's a little experiment to see if we can help people get here at different times because of the bad weather. We're happy to bring you this service. We have programs here to help the poor. Call the church office. We have coming up a skating party this coming Sunday. And the first Sunday in every month we have skating parties or other parties, things for the youth to get together with the earlier Sunday school. We'll have more time for the youth after the 9:30 service. 9:30 service will be over about 10:30. This is the 28th of January, the fourth Sunday after the Epiphany. The Epiphany was when the wise men came to worship Jesus. They were the first Gentiles. The Christianity is open to the Gentiles, it's open to everybody. Today our reader was Kim Jackson, who read the wonderful readings about walking humbly with our God, all the things that we should do. God asks us to do, to love the poor, and He calls the poor. He keeps us as a remnant. As long as we worship, we pray that God will have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins, and then we can help others be a servant to others. Our ushers were Sharon Leach and Helen Wallace, and we have Holy Communion next Sunday. We have Holy Communion on Wednesday at 6:30 in the chapel. We have Holy Communion 9:30 this coming Sunday here. We receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ. We're nourished by his body and blood. He died for us to save us from our sins. He is with us every minute. We're all part of him. We're able to walk humbly with our God, to love justice, to love mercy, to do good, to love our neighbors as ourselves, to put God first. Don't put America first. Don't put ourselves first. Put God first. Listen to God's word. Put him first. This will bring us happiness. Just as it says in the Beatitudes, the meek shall inherit the earth, and those who love justice will inherit the earth. We should be just. We should love mercy. We should love our neighbors. We should follow the Ten Commandments. These are the things we're supposed to do, and God will have mercy on us. We'll be a remnant. We hope that we can be a servant nation. We can be a remnant. We can be people who love God enough that we can help save others. We want everybody to be saved. We want us all to be together to love one another. We pray for you. Pray for our ministry. YouTube, tell people about this. They can hear the word of God. They can worship virtually on their computers, with their TVs. They can listen to us. They can worship God. God asks us to do this. He's the creator of the universe. We're in touch with the creator of the universe, and we should obey him. He's not created. He created everything, including us.